good.
Dr. Allred will lead us in the
much that we live in a community such as this, that when we come to a meeting, that we first stop and we talk to you about it. Father, I pray that you would guide all of our thoughts, our words, our attitudes, our hearts, that you would give us wisdom, that you would give us awareness, and that you would give us understanding. Thank you for blessing our city in so many ways, Lord. We love you.
Very community. Again, thank you for your appreciation.
I'd also like to say thank you for giving the opportunity to work with you guys, and I really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Let me start by saying thank you for what you do each and every day, putting your life on the line to protect all of us citizens of the city of Perry. And I know that's very difficult, but we truly appreciate what you're doing each and every day. And I too agree with you, the fact that you are working for the best force there is in the state of Georgia, and we're glad you've made that choice to join us. Council?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Council.
Thank you, Chief. Item 4B, Peaches to Beaches application. A representative from the Lions Club will be attending the council meeting to present the application. Is there anyone here from the Lions Club?
Yes, sir.
Would you please give us your name and address, please, for the record?
Sandy Casita, 8244, is my home in Perry, Georgia.
It's okay if you take your mask down so lawyers can hear.
You're better.
Thank you.
I'm just here to represent the Perry Lions Club. We're submitting our annual application for Peaches to the Beaches, which is usually in March, but has been postponed this year to the first weekend in August.
And I guess the application is filled out, and your requests are in that?
Yes, sir, that's all.
Chief Lynn, have you guys reviewed the application?
I'm not sure we have. We've seen it previously. It's the same one.
Same one we had back in March.
It's in it before the rescheduling.
Council members, at this time, I'll entertain a motion to approve this application subject to the police department's review of it. Motion is second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Thank you, Richard. The application is approved. And if you'll work with Chief Lynn to get his review of it, we appreciate it. Thank you very much. We're looking for a very successful piece of speeches in cool laws.
We hope so. Thank you.
Council members, I'd like to take a point of personal privilege at this point in time. This item is not on the agenda. This would be 4C. And we'd like to wish Ms. Mildred Mace a happy 100th birthday. We will be celebrating her birthday with her and her family on Sunday, a family gathering with a city proclamation. So happy birthday to her, and we look forward to joining family on Sunday out at Rozier Park. Thank you. Item 5 is community partners update. Are there any community partners here that would like to address mayor and council at this time? Thank you. Item 6 on our agenda this evening is citizens with input. Are there any citizens here that would like to address mayor and council with items that are not the same items that will be addressed in the public hearing? Yes, if you would come to the microphone and give us your name and address, please.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, Mayor and Council, for allowing me to speak tonight. My name is Alexi Starling. I reside at the 316 Shane Circle, and I'm currently on the agenda this evening regarding the special exceptions in home salon. I've been a stylist for 6 years now and have currently worked in 2 salons during that time frame. Over the past few years, I've established a steady and trustworthy clientele that have become more like family to me than clients. I no longer have to advertise my business. I've always had the mindset that I wanted to work from my home eventually. performing services for my clients, just like the stylist that I used to go to years ago. Having an in-home salon is a pretty common request, and now since COVID, it seems to be even more of a priority for my business and myself going forward. Along with myself, I have several clients who are considered high risk, and those who are still very uneasy about COVID in general. Several clients have stated that they would be much more comfortable coming into my home because there is less risk for exposure as opposed to a salon setting, in a salon setting. I am here this evening to show you all how important this agenda is to me. This is my livelihood and the way I make a living. I'm just trying to do the right thing and to go about getting the city's approval for my business just as any honest person should. I know you're wondering who these people are I have standing behind me. These people consist of family, friends, neighbors, and clients. Everyone who took time out of their evenings and time away from their families to come and stand behind me to show their support. I also have a list of signatures right here from a few others within our neighborhood that were not able to attend this evening. So in closing, I just ask that Mayor and Council take into consideration that I'm really trying to go above and beyond for this approval. I have already submitted documents to the state regarding my in-home salon as well. I'm aware of all the requirements that I need to do once my salon has been completely set up. I have been compliant regarding all the regulations that have been set by, I will be compliant regarding all the regulations that have been set by the planning committee in the first hearing. And now I just need the trust from you all that I will continue to do so going forward. Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the council at this time? Thank you. Item 7 is public hearing. At this time, I would like to refer you to the screens. These are the policies and procedures that govern our zoning hearings. These are in hard copy in the doorway on the next to the officer there, if you would like to have a hard copy of it. The purpose of this public hearing is to provide any interested party with an opportunity to express their views and concerns in accordance with OCGA section 36-66-4. This public hearing is now open. Item 7A is an annexation request. It's ANNX-188-2020. The applicant is N&D Development, LLC. They're requesting the rezoning and annexation of property from R-8G County Residential Agricultural District to R-2A City Single Family Residential District. The property is located at 111 Hill Road. The tax map number is 000580-034000. Ms. Wharton.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor and Council, thank you for having me. If you will take a look at the screen, I'd like to show you an aerial photo of this property that we're looking at. Alright, this property is outlined in blue here. Properties to the north are properties that front on Main Street. To the east is the existing Ivy Glen subdivision. To the south is a property currently in the city zone R1. And then to the west is Hill Road and some single family homes in that direction. The applicant is requesting to annex the 5.67 acre property located at 111 Hill Road. The property is currently zoned RAG in the county, and the applicant is requesting the City of Perry R2A single family residential zoning classification. R2A requires a minimum lot size of 12,000 square feet and a minimum lot width of 80 feet. The applicant has submitted a site plan for this project, and the lot sizes for this portion of the development range between 13,587 square feet and 22,063 square feet. These properties are outlined in red on the site plan. There are six standards for establishing a zoning classification when considering an application for annexation. Staff has provided an analysis for each of the following. Number one, are there covenants and restrictions pertaining to the property which would preclude the uses permitted in the proposed zoning district? The applicant indicates that there are no covenants or restrictions pertaining to the property which would preclude uses allowed in the R2A zoning district. Number two, describe how uses permitted in the proposed zoning district are compatible with uses and development of surrounding properties. The R2A zoning classification permits single-family residential uses. Surrounding properties consist of single-family residential development on lots between 3/4 acre and 5 acres, and more than 5 acres. As proposed, single-family residential use of the subject property is consistent with the use of surrounding properties. Number three, describe why the proposed zoning district will not adversely impact the use of surrounding properties. Single-family residential use should not adversely impact the residential use of surrounding properties. Number four, describe how the proposed zoning district is consistent with the comprehensive plan. The subject property is located in the Gateway Corridor Character Area, identified in the 2017 Joint Comprehensive Plan update. This portion of the Gateway Corridor was identified as the future phase of Perry Parkway. However, due to the existence of several existing subdivisions in the path, it's unlikely that Perry Parkway would be extended in the path identified within the plan. So you'll notice on the screen, the green area is the Gateway Corridor Character Area. So, disregarding the Gateway Corridor identification, the subject property would be located in the suburban residential area. That's the area in purple on the map you see. The comprehensive plan states that within the suburban residential area, there's a lack of higher density neighborhoods. Suggested development patterns within this character area includes the location of higher density housing near commercial centers or along arterial roads. The proposed R2A zoning classification and development is consistent with the suggested uses and development patterns within the suburban residential character area. Number five, describe how the proposed zoning district will not cause an excessive burden upon existing public facilities and services. Regarding infrastructure, the proposed development is not expected to cause an excessive burden upon existing public facilities and services. Based on staff review of this proposed project relative to the existing and planned infrastructure, the city has adequate capacity to serve the development with its existing water, sanitary sewer, stormwater, and natural gas facilities. The proposed development will be required to comply with all relevant stormwater regulations. Regarding roads, the primary streets impacted as a result of this development are Hill Road, Tucker Road, and Main Street. Hill Road and Tucker Road are classified as collector streets. Main Street is classified as an arterial. These streets have adequate capacity to serve the proposed development. Regarding schools, the Houston County Board of Education has been notified of this proposed development. Staff is not aware of any issues related to the capacity of educational facilities resulting from the proposed development. Number six, describe any other existing or changing conditions affecting the use and development of the subject property, which would support approval of the requested zoning district. There is strong demand for additional residential development in Houston County, particularly in the areas east of Perry. Regarding property values, Based on staff research from the previous 2 years, using data gathered from the Houston County Tax Assessor, homes located in the R2A zoning district and near the subject property range in sales price from $139,000 to $420,000. Staff anticipates that the selling price of the homes proposed would fall within this range. The Houston County Commission has been notified of this annexation application and concurred with the request for R2A zoning. The City of Perry staff recommended approval of this application as reflected in the staff report dated March 22, 2021. The Perry Planning Commission recommended approval of this application at the informational hearing held on April 12, 2021. That's all.
Council members, what questions do you have relative to this annexation and rezoning request?
Just so I am correct, you said with R1, the minimum lot size is 15,000?
Yes.
Square. Okay, and then with the R2A, it was 12,000 square feet?
In R2A, duplexes or townhouses of any kind are not allowed, is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Other questions, Council members? Thank you, Ms. Worthen. Is there anyone here that would like to speak in favor of this annexation and zoning request?
Development sector, piping, all that as well. So, yes, sir.
any of these homes be custom built, or will they be just, you will have certain standard bills that you repeat?
We will have floor plans that you can choose from with multiple upgrades. And if we do have pre-solds, yes, ma'am, they can pick, you know, what they want to build in there, as long as it falls into our plan category we provide for them. And that way, if they want to make modifications, yes, ma'am.
So that would be available to them to make alterations or modifications?
Yes, ma'am. And for our guidelines, what we let them do, yes, ma'am.
You developed subdivisions, I think, in the city of Perry before. Is there one that you could point to that in your mind this would be most analogous to?
We're building in multiple subdivisions throughout the city period of season, sorry. Development-wise, we developed New Haven, we're currently developing Sadie Heights, and we're building in multiple subdivisions. We built through Hawks Landing, Stonebridge. We're part of some other developments that are coming up in the city of Perry. We build anywhere from, right now, you know, it's sad to say when you get to a starter home, it's starting in the mid-200s, and up from there, I mean, it's just so hard to kind of, you know, fall into any category less than that right now with how high everything is and how everything's kind of getting in the building industry.
Now, being familiar with some of those developments that you mentioned, New Haven to Stonebridge is there are two extremely different developments. What give us a...
We built in Hawks Landing, the Woodlands, and Paston. There's been multiple of them that we've built throughout the city of Perry.
Do you feel like the one you're building here would be more perhaps like the Woodlands?
No, ma'am. It's not going to be like New Haven. It's going to be more like kind of the Hawks Landing product. They're a brick product. They have, you know, different accents on the front. They're not going to be 3,000 square foot. They're going to be a little less than that.
A little less than 3,000.
Yes, ma'am. Stormwater management. We feel as though we've created a, you know, sizable stormwater management area to control it on site. I haven't got, you know, too deep in hydrology reports and all that yet, but from the size of it, we did maximize it to ensure we wouldn't have an issue on stormwater runoff or anything pertaining to that. Yes, sir.
Additional questions for Mr. Wingate?
One more, Mayor. With this one, you said you're a developer of yourself. Does there be plans at any time to flip this to another developer or any such entity at all?
No, sir, not at all. We would be the sole builder and developer throughout the whole project.
Thank you, Mr. Wingate.
Yes, sir, thank you.
Is there anyone here that would like to speak against this annexation and rezoning request? We have your name and address, please. You can remove your mask if you would like.
My name is Keith Beckham, and I live at 2071 U.S. Highway 341 South, which is on the plat of a little lot that is a 5-acre lot for the county there on the north side. I've got a couple of handouts. I'd like to ask your permission to talk about the rezoning and the annexation together for just a second, because it goes hand in hand if you don't do it. First off, let's say, I was born and raised in Perry. My father was the mayor in 1960 to 63, so I'm very familiar with change in Perry. I have no opposition to change. I work for a company here in Perry, and change is good for us. Increased citizens for the city of Perry in our area is beneficial to our business. So I'm not against or opposed to the annexation. This is a density question, and I am opposed to the density change from R1 to R2A. If the property were to be annexed into the city, I would plead for an R1 designation. Since the property that adjoins is currently zoned R1, this property is not contiguous to any property that is zoned less than R1 currently. This annexation is deliberately circumventing the intent of the ordinance by gerrymandering a 10-foot by 220-foot strip to touch only 10 foot approximately of county property, so that it does not create an island in the city. While this is legal, I truly believe this is not the intent of the ordinance to do this. I'm not arguing against the legality of it. I'm arguing against the part of the ordinance to maintain no islands for county property in the city. Third point, uses of our ag, which our properties are, which there's five or six up there that are our ag, allows us to do things that city residents probably would not be amenable to. We can use our property for agricultural purposes, livestock. There could be chemical spray to help with pests or herbicides or that kind of thing that would be in conflict with the higher density. I noticed that the new plat, since we've seen several, does not have a step up in land on the north side like it does the south side. The lots abutting 5-acre tracts are still R2. That's going to put 2.5 houses behind our houses that are our ag. I can understand reaching a compromise with one person on the uses of my property as our ag, but I can assure you it'll be a lot harder, in fact 2.5 times harder, to negotiate the uses of my property with 2.5 houses behind me, which I believe will increase conflict between the owners of our ag in the county and the owners of the property in the city proposed annexation. I can give you an example. I've already had animal ordinance come out of my house because my dog's barking, but I live in the county. There's no ordinance against it, and I had to tell the officer exactly where I live in the county, not the city. The property zone our ag were purchased with intent that zoning was settled. In fact, their reports, and I'll quote, only on the south side is the property above a lot without any existing residents. We bought our properties with the assurance that it was R1 or ag. Again, I'm not opposing the annexation. I'm opposing the density. If all the houses around it were sold and built with R1 zoning there, argue that that is a breach of the duties of the city to maintain the current zoning. Next, I'd like to call your attention to the color-coded map. You'll see there's a little section that I just kind of outlined there that's got the actual property that's in question. If you'll look at that, that's the actual property in question between the annexation rezoning request. The mustard color piece of property, that yellow color right there, all that's R2, which is a higher density. Now, I asked this question to planning and zoning, and I was not given an answer. But my question is, how many lots are planted and unbuilt in a R2? Because obviously their argument is that there's a need for more R2 and higher density. Well, I didn't get an answer about how many lots are planted and not built R2. Then I asked the question, how many acres have been zoned R2 and not built on or planted? And I didn't get an answer for that either. So I did a little bit of research, pulled up properties that are highlighted on the current zoning map, which are mustard color properties. So within 2 miles of this rezoning request, an R2 request, there are 543.87 acres currently zoned R2. There are 258 acres zoned R1. So where is the need to rezone this to R2? You've got almost double or more than double the amount of R2 acreage already zoned R2 than R1. I can't understand the reasoning. And if that's planning, you're planning the opposite of what you're currently doing. The argument that this should be rezoned as residential 2A, since it's currently zoned RA and residential R1, can be argued on both sides. Their argument is residential, this is just higher density. Well, since it's R1, why should we zone R2? It's still residential. This is clearly rezoning density for profit, not for need. One of their arguments was property has not been developed because of numerous reasons, unspoken, over the period of time since 2009. Obviously, the property has been purchased and held for speculative nature, and now we're coming to develop it, and they're requesting R2. However, if you look at the smaller piece of property, the small page, the dark gray is Ivy Glen subdivision, which is does not touch the annexation piece, but it does touch the other rezoning piece. That property was purchased in 2005. The property under question for rezoning was purchased in 2009. And their argument is zoning in R2 will drive development on the east side of Perry. Obviously, that's false. This property of Ivy Glen has been undeveloped. The 92 acres, even it has 40 lots in it, platted, unbuilt, and has not driven any development to this side of here. Again, all properties surrounding it are larger than R1 or R2 at the minimum. The next point I have is the new plat, which we've seen three already. Not have to step up on the north side to the next lot size from 2A as it does on the south side, which would be a violation of the city ordinance as it's written. Number 9, there's abundance of R2 adjacent to the property. Like I said, there's 92 acres. It's undeveloped R2, along with an additional 40 lots of R2, which is 2.6 times the size of what we're being being asked to rezone and annex. Number 10, the diminished value of the land is R1 property and unused space serves no purpose for the general welfare of the city. Provides no opportunity for housing or expansion of the tax base while costing goods and services provided to the city. Right now, it's raw land. It's not costing the city anything to maintain that property or provide any goods and services to it. So that argument is null. There's no law that requires any request for rezoning to be approved. This is an unreasonable request. It's not a struggle or impediment to the value of the property or developing the property. As you can see, which I stated earlier, there's 543 acres of R2. There's only 258 acres of R1. So the argument that this gives more diversity to housing in Perry is exactly the opposite of what this rezoning request is. The last thing I want to end with is if you can answer affirmatively to any of the items that I've given, you would have to vote against the rezoning of this property to R2 or R2A. I'm a banker by profession. I've worked through the 2008 real estate crisis. I foreclosed on a lot of property from friends and neighbors in this area, which was hard for me personally. I'm not comparing the current bubble to the 2008 crisis because that was an intermediary market funding flow crisis, but we are going to have slower building moving forward. Due to the interest, this is an interest rate driven flurry of activity. These low rates will not continue, and we will end up with lots undeveloped again, just like in Ivy Glen, contiguous to this property that's asking to be rezoned. If it hadn't been developed, it's going to have weeds and trees growing up there. That is not far away. Wage constraints will limit the ability to purchase homes. As the developer said, the costs are extreme right now. $250,000 for a starter home will end shortly. If I could predict that, I wouldn't be standing here having this argument with you tonight, obviously. But it will end. Will it end before this property is developed? Maybe, maybe not. But obviously, there is not a need for the city to rezone this from R2, from R1, R2, or annex it in at R2. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Beckham. Appreciate your comments. Anyone else would like to speak against? Questions. I have a few objections and some observations relative
purpose of that? The property was rezoned R1, remains zoned R1. The applicant has provided the council with no evidence to demonstrate why the property cannot be developed as R1. Why would the council not benefit from that knowledge? If they had that knowledge, you could make a more informed decision about whether R2 is more appropriate than R1. The applicant's assertion that the property has not been developed is not a reason to rezone the property. The property is already zoned for residential development as R1, which is consistent with all of the surrounding homeowners. The applicant's assertion that the current zoning may not be economically feasible is not supported by any studies or facts from the owner or from the developer. The owner and the developer have not tried to develop the property as it is currently zoned as R1. They've made no effort to do that. They provided no evidence to you that it's not feasible. And so, for that reason alone, I would think it would not make sense to rezone the property until you have that information before you. There is not, to my knowledge, been a showing by the applicant that there would be a substantial detriment if the property remains zoned as R1, which is a legal standard, of course, that you have to show if you were trying to have property rezoned. Substantial detriment is not. I don't believe that Georgia law supports the applicant and the developer's assertion that the property value is diminished as currently zoned, and it is not a reason to rezone the property in and of itself. Georgia law supports the fact that profit motive alone is no reason to rezone the property. Evidence that it would be difficult to develop the property as currently zoned, or that the owner developer will only suffer an economic loss unless the property is rezoned, is not sufficient to support the legal conclusion that the owner will suffer a significant detriment if not rezoned. Now, that's Gwinnett County versus Davis, which was the Georgia Supreme Court case that was decided in 1997, where the applicant was unable to show that there was a substantial detriment to the fact that the property was not rezoned. Economic loss, as the property was purchased by the owner as R1. He's not trying to develop it as R1. The fact that he may not be able to make as much money by not having it zoned as R2, in my opinion, is not something that the council should consider as a part of their decision. Is the rezoning request consistent, and does it conform to the surrounding homes? We submit, or I submit, that it does not. The surrounding homes of the subject property are mainly, as they mentioned here before, 0.75 acres to over 5 acre lots. My house is on a property, I have a lot next to me, combined the two properties, it's about roughly 2.5 acres. The proposed rezoning request is not consistent with that. It doesn't conform to the surrounding neighborhoods of 341, which is R.A., Hill Road, China Berry subdivision, even Devonwood and Tucker Road subdivisions. They have large lots, and it's just not consistent with what has been built over the last 35 or 40 years in that area of the city of Perry. Existing homeowners have relied on the R1 zoning and the property that is being requested to be rezoned for many decisions relative to their homes in Perry. Everything from construction to renovation to expansion. Actually, many of the homeowners in our area relied upon the original RAG zoning when they decided to build their homes before it became R1 in 2000. We have not been provided with a traffic study, and I know that just about every zoning objection has a traffic objection to it. And I'm not a traffic engineer, but I do think it's important to point out a couple of factors relevant to traffic. Hill Road is a 2-lane blacktop that is a very busy road as it currently sits. Most of the intersection, most of the traffic that goes down goes to 341. And you have a bypass intersecting with 341. That is a very dangerous intersection. There's already been at least one fatality that I'm aware of in Hill Road at 341. No traffic study has been provided to the council. But should the development be successfully built out to 63 homes, Mr. Beckman doesn't think that it will be, but if it were to be, and each home had an average of 2 automobiles per residence, average three trips per car on average per day. That's 378 additional vehicles on the hill road every day. And that's going to be concentrated during the hours, generally between 7 a.m. and 6 p.m. in the evening. That doesn't consider other traffic. It doesn't consider postal vehicles, delivery vehicles, maintenance vehicles, construction vehicles. It's going to be a major traffic problem for the need to density. Existing city of Perry ordinance regarding such property is something that was discussed in planning and zoning, and I'd like to touch on it tonight. When the subject property came before the council to be zoned to R1, the city passed an ordinance, which is still in effect, requiring that there be a buffer between China Berry subdivision and the subject property, as well as a restriction on holding retention ponds on the subject property. That was a condition preceding to the property being zoned to R1. The ordinance is specific. It states an adequate buffer slash drainage right-of-way bordering the property shall be conveyed to the city by fee simple title or dedicated easements. It is specific and it is not vague, it is not ambiguous. It's an ordinance that was passed by the city council. In closing, I would like to point out that it was suggested in the city's pre-council minutes that making a decision, the city council should not be swayed by the number of people present at this meeting. I would agree with that. However, I would also ask the city to consider the interest of all of the taxpaying citizens who signed a petition objecting to this rezoning, and that have attended all of the meetings and that most of the many of which are present tonight. Your decision affects the citizens and the homeowners of the city of Perry, particularly in that area, not just the owner and developer. That, I close, and thank you for your time, and hope that you will not remove this zoning as it is at all. Thank you, Christian, for your comments.
Is there anyone else here that would like to speak against the annexation and the rezoning of the annexation of the parcel? Yes, sir, could you give us your name and address, please?
My name is Guy Storm, live 117 Wellington Drive, which is in Devonwood subdivision. I'm not as near as prepared as the gentleman that were in front of me, but I'm speaking to you as a father and a family man. I moved to Houston County 7 years ago from Jones County. My wife and I have looked for a subdivision that had access for children. We bought a home that was foreclosed on, we rebuilt it from the studs on out on 2 acres. Now, we butt up against this new subdivision? No, we don't. We butt up against China Berry? No, we don't. Our access is Tucker Road. Last Halloween, I had to stand on Tucker Road and do jumping jacks to keep cars from slowing down so my friends and family would let our children trick-or-treat. Do I want another 63 houses accessing Tucker Road and Hill Road? No, I do not. I have zero problems with this development going forward as an R1 subdivision. Build houses on 1 acre, 2 acre, 3 acres. Build big houses. Build beautiful houses. We looked at homes all across Houston County. We moved. Now, granted, I'm a Houston County resident. I am not a City of Perry resident. I understand that. But we looked at homes all across to see where do we want to raise our kids. And we chose Perry, and we chose a subdivision that attaches to Perry. We go to Methodist Church here in Perry. Our kid goes to Westville. Here we are. Just don't feel like this county should push putting 65 homes on a 2-lane blacktop that already has traffic problems. So if you look at the junction of Perry Parkway and 341, the state has already tried to put up little flags and do little things here and there. It's a horrible intersection. So here we are, we're gonna add 400, 500, 600, 700 cars a day. So the gentleman in front of me didn't bring up the Amazon deliveries. So if we can go in through COVID, how many people get 15 Amazon boxes on the front porch every week, like my wife orders? I just don't feel like this is a good use of our land in Houston County. I feel like the homes and the property values around it deserve R1. We talk about $250,000 houses. I just put a front porch on my home. It cost me $50,000 to put a front porch on my home with the building prices where they are and where the contractor pricing are. And I own a contracting company. I do industrial, not residential. But it cost me $50,000 to put a front porch on my home. So what is a $250,000 house in these prices? It's a 1,500, 1,600, 1,700 square foot home. I live in a 3,000 square foot home as the crow flies 500 yards from the subdivision. I just don't feel like this is a good use of the city of Perry's resources in Houston County. I just don't see it. I think you're going to drive down the entire area. I think you're going to drive down their home prices. Increased traffic. I think you're going to overload Tucker Elementary School. And that's why I oppose this annexation in the city of Perry. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to address relative to the annexation and rezoning?
Greetings, Council. My name is David Frazier. I live at 2081 Main Street. The neighbor, my neighbor has already spoke, and I am down on there. One on this one, second from the larger one. The story I like to tell is that we have horses, three horses. My wife loves quite a bit, and we are concerned with so many homes sitting on our parking line with different individuals who are not involved because the law's not going to allow it. Any type of agricultural pursuits, they might have dogs, they might have cats, but they can't have any large mammals. And my wife and I are afraid, or concerned about how the horses are going to react, going to be spooked, and how that is going to make it harder for her to train. And because it's one reason to change, as many of you have already said, it no longer being agricultural. And this is why I feel that it dramatically changes the neighborhood and changes the area and changes how our life is going to be. And I would request, as others have said, that this annexation not occur, it would definitely not be rezoned to RG if it does occur.
Thank you. Anyone else would like to speak directly relative to the annexation and rezoning of this 5 acres?
My name is Hugh Hill, and Mayor and Council, I thank you for this opportunity. And I would like to voice my opposition to this rezoning request. I live 109 Houston Woods, Perry. But I grew up on Hill Road, starting in 1960, dirt road. Tucker Road was a dirt road. And nothing against growth. It's grown up around that property. My sister and I own approximately 50 acres on the west side of Hill Road still. But it's been controlled and measured. We even sold, or my mother when she was still alive, we sold some property on Tucker Road, fronting Tucker Road, but we put in covenants so that it would be complementary to the area, to some of the houses that were already there. The acreage had to be one plus, and to maintain that conformity. This proposition to rezone is going against that whole area as far as being conforming or complementary. Now, this application from the developers to the city of Perry had some comments or had some standards for granting a rezone. And I want to make some comments on those standards in that rezoning because that was part of the application. The property has been rezoned R1 and has been sold 5 times. That was mentioned before. So it sat dormant without fulfilling its intended use. Well, that's by choice. Nobody is stopping them from developing it at R1. There could be economic issues, there could be financial issues, or whatever. It's not, you know, a detriment if it's by choice. Nobody's stopping them from doing it at R1. That's the excuse, and that should be irrelevant. Also, they made the comment, this is the standards for granting a rezone. The diminished value of the land as R1 in an unused state serves no purpose towards the general welfare of the citizens of the city of Perry, provides no opportunity for housing or the expansion of the city of Perry tax base for goods and services. Really? R1, you can expand the tax base. You know, you have opportunities there. You don't have to change the zoning for it to be developed unless, as mentioned before, profit motive. And that's no guarantee when you buy a piece of property or you buy a business or whatever. There's no guarantee that profit is going to come automatically. Another issue, rezoning to R2A would provide the public access to more housing choices. You can have more housing choices with R1 if it gets developed at R1. So that's a moot point. Again, they commented about being sold and undeveloped as A3. That's been discussed. Now that's by choice. The surrounding properties are all residential. The proposed 2A will allow a smaller option for home buyers. And as the needs of the homeowners change, these houses provide future buyers for surrounding larger lot homes and properties. Really? Are people going to stay there and just move next door, maybe to a bigger house? I mean, that's not an argument. The use is complementary. No, it's not. You've got R1 all around, and putting in the R2A, the smaller lots, the smaller homes, is not being complementary to the area. And one last thing, the proposed development will provide a greater mix of choices for buyers and the potential to draw more development to the east side. Well, that's already been brought up. You've got all these R2As, R2s that haven't been developed. So that doesn't make sense. But none of their arguments really hold water. And one last thing, when you put in a development, or you would think a development that comes into your area, it would be positive. It would enhance the property values, or there would be some positive things to go along with. There are no positives with changing the zoning to 2A. It's negative. Traffic. And ask the property owners that live at the front on Hill Road if their value is going to increase when you've got 150 cars going right by your house every day. Those values are definitely going to decrease, and it may have overlapping effect on the rest of the properties in that area. So I would like to voice my opposition to this zoning change, and I mayor and council for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you, Mr. Hilton. Is there anyone else that would like to speak against?
How you doing? Leon Jackson, 141 Hill Road. That's what trying to put the subject right behind my house, and basically the road in between the house as well. I've been here since 06. 2006, I moved right here. I want to be in a nice area, quiet area, less traffic, got kids to raise, grandkids. And then all that traffic, I mean, rezoned to R2A, definitely not going to make it. R1 is okay, we still want that as well, but you're looking at probably 2 to 3 cars, maybe 4 cars per house. And that road's coming right beside me. And I already have a hard time even now, just with the regular traffic. If you got all the cars coming at the same time, you might put a red stop sign up there, a red light. And it's more important, I mean, it's all about making money, yes it is, but think about the lives you're going, who can be killed, more traffic coming in. We're not looking at all safety. It's a safety cost here, I mean, it's real bad. You got to fix that. Less people in the subdivision behind it make a lot better. I mean, that's all I said, gonna make it. The road in, the road can't make it, get out. I tried to come to meet, and I'm almost late coming here now. I left 15 minutes till. It took about 8 minutes to get out of the road. Asking to pull out in front of the car to get down. Imagine all the cars from the road at the same time in the morning, the buses, the farm equipment coming through the farmers, stuff being delivered. The road won't hold it. Neighborhood, I mean, definitely going to be a nobody's talking about no safety at all. That's what I'm saying. But what's the safety of it? And what's the cost of the lights that we're putting up? I mean, here, nothing really being explained real well. Everything's just a guess. Listen, I'm like everybody's been sitting in the sun beside me, coming on the road every day. I love where I stand. I don't want to be like the one around going watching at 6 o'clock getting off work. You see, you can't ride around Watson Boulevard on a birthday. That's what's going to be like every day on our street. You got people coming out Perry Parkway, trying to get on to Main Street, trying to get off Hill Road, turn up. Accident waiting, it's going to happen every day. I know it's about money, but think about the lives you're going to be hurting on a long way. Something to think about. House the county want to make more money, period. Sometimes it's good to let some stuff lay down low and make a little bit, and they better make more down the road. It's been a subdivisions in a country that you want a big old, what you want, R2A, R2, whatever, all of that. But I move where I'm at because I like the area. It's quiet, got good neighbors. My kids can be out in the yard playing. I see it now, they have a subdivision come through the road and somebody on the phone talking and running out the road and coming to my yard. Trying to dodge somebody else coming in the other direction. And it's right beside my house. Right beside. If y'all think about the safety, it makes it be R1, I'd be okay with that. But R2A, it's not gonna help us at all, it's gonna hurt us. You'll see that down the road, definitely gonna see it now. And wish I would change my mind.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate your comments. Is there anyone else who would like to address council relative to this annexation in this part?
Thank you. My name is Jeff Wilson. I live at 129 Brickman Drive. I spent a lot of this afternoon right in front of Mr. Jackson's house, riding bikes with my 9-year-old daughter. We bought the house in 2003, and we were very excited to live in an area where we could grow as a family. At that point in time, it was different. Right now, I'm a school teacher. At that point, I work in construction. 2008, I think they brought that up earlier, 2008 got me out of the construction business and into the teaching business. And the one thing I was very proud of in the move was not only the decision that I made, was I was very proud of Perry for controlling growth. This is one of those things that I understand, you know, being in construction for so long, it's important to some people to make sure that this goes in the most profitable fashion, but it's also important that we protect the people around them. As far as COVID goes, I spent the last year of my freshman career learning how to do online learning. Not only did I have to teach my kids that way, my students that way, I had to teach my children that way. And if we look at this, and if we look at Chinaberry, and if we look at Devonwood, and we look at this, it's one of those questions where you have a duck, and a fishing pole, which one doesn't fit? I just hope that we protect one another. I hope the best for everybody involved. I think it's been said many times today, nobody here, I do not think, is scared of growth. But let's grow together and not apart from one another. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. We appreciate that. Is there anybody else that would like to speak against at this time? Item 7B on our agenda this evening is a rezoning request. It's RZNE189-2020. The applicant is N&D Development LLC. Request the rezoning of property from R-1 Single Family Residential District to R-2A Single Family Residential District. The property is located at 125 Hill Road. The tax map number is 0P0480035000. Wharton.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor and Council, please take a look at the screen. The subject property is outlined in blue. The property to the north is the previous parcel we've been discussing related to the annexation. The property to the east is the existing Ivy Glen subdivision. To the west is Hill Road, and to the south is Chinaberry Subdivision. The applicant is requesting to rezone the 25.52 acre parcel located at 125 Hill Road from R1 Single Family Residential to R2A Single Family Residential. The applicant had previously requested the R3 zoning classification. However, following the informational hearing held at the April 12, 2021 Perry Planning Commission, the applicant amended his application to request R2A, single family residential. This is a less intense zoning classification. R2A requires a minimum lot size of 12,000 square feet and a minimum lot width of 80 feet. The applicant has submitted a site plan for this project, which includes 63 lots, and the lot sizes for this portion of the development range between 12,000 square feet and 24,061 square feet. The site plan reflects 5 lots abutting Chinaberry Subdivision. Each of these lots are a minimum of 24,000 square feet. This is 9,000 square feet larger than the minimum lot size for R1. The dimensions of these transition lots are required by the City of Perry's Land Management Ordinance. This is required when R2A lots abut R1 lots. There are 12 standards governing zone changes. Staff has provided an analysis for each of the following. Number one, the existing land uses and zoning classification of nearby property. Like I mentioned previously, the property to the north of the subject is zoned RAG in the county and is undeveloped. This was the subject of the previous annexation application with the recommended R2A zoning. The property to the south is zoned R1 single family residential, and it's the existing Chinaberry subdivision. The property to the east is zoned R2, two family residential. This property is currently undeveloped, but has been identified for future phases of Ivy Glen subdivision. This development was approved for the construction of single-family homes. The properties to the west are zoned R1, in the city and RAG in the county. These properties include single-family homes. This number two, the suitability of the subject property for the zone purposes. The property is suitable for residential development. Number three, the extent to which the property values of the subject property are diminished by the particular zoning restrictions. The R1 zoning classification requires a larger minimum lot size than the R2A zoning classification. This causes a reduction in the number of lots which can be developed. The applicant states that the property has been sold 5 times since 1983 under its current zoning. The applicant also states that the property is not fulfilling its highest and best use because of that fact. Number four, the extent to which the destruction of property values of the subject property promotes the health, safety, morals, or general welfare of the public. The use of the property for single-family residential development, whether it's developed under the provisions of R1 or R2A, does not have a significant impact on the health, safety, morals, or general welfare of the public. Number five, the relative gain to the public as compared to the hardship imposed upon the individual property owner. There does not appear to be any gain for the public by limiting the density of the subject property to that of the R1 district, while the R2A district allows approximately 10 more lots than would be allowed in the R1 district, the use remains single-family residential. The previous application requesting R3 included a site plan which reflected 78 lots for single-family homes. The amended application requesting R2A includes a site plan reflecting 63 lots. Number six, whether the subject property has a reasonable economic use as currently zoned. In reference to the reasonable economic use, the application states that the property has been repeatedly sold and undeveloped since 1983. Number seven, the length of time the property has been vacant as zoned considered in the context of land development in the area in the vicinity of the property. The subject property has never been developed, although adjacent and nearby properties have been developed as single-family subdivisions in a range of lot sizes and price points. Number eight, whether the proposed rezoning will be a use that is suitable in view of the uses and development of adjacent and nearby property. The R2A zoning classification permits single-family residential uses. Surrounding properties consist of single-family residential development on lots from 3/4 acre to approximately 2.5 acres. Single-family residential use of the subject property is consistent with the use of surrounding properties. Number nine, whether the proposed rezoning will adversely affect the existing use or usability of adjacent or nearby property. Single-family residential use should not adversely impact the residential use of surrounding properties. Lot sizes along the perimeter of the proposed subdivision will create a transition from existing large lots to smaller lots in the proposed subdivision. Number 10, whether the zoning proposal is in conformity with the policies and intent of the land use plan. The subject property is located in the Gateway Corridor area in the 2017 Joint Comprehensive Plan update. This portion of the Gateway Corridor was identified as a future phase of Perry Parkway. However, due to the existence of several existing subdivisions in the path, it's unlikely that Perry Parkway would be extended as identified in the plan. This is the same point from the previous application and the same map we have here. So, disregarding the Gateway Corridor identification, the subject property would be located in the suburban residential character area identified for the surrounding properties. The comprehensive plan states that within suburban residential, there is a lack of higher density neighborhoods. Suggested development patterns within this character area includes the location of higher density housing near commercial centers or along arterial roads. The proposed R2A zoning classification and development is consistent with the suggested use and development patterns within the suburban residential character area. Number 11. Whether the zoning proposal will result in a use which could cause an excessive or burdensome use of existing streets, transportation facilities, utilities, or schools. Regarding infrastructure, the proposed development is not expected to cause an excessive burden on existing public facilities and services. Based on staff review of this proposed project relative to the existing and the planned infrastructure, the city has adequate capacity to serve the development with its existing water, sanitary sewer, stormwater, and natural gas facilities. The proposed development will be required to comply with all relevant stormwater regulations. Regarding roads, the primary streets impacted as a result of this development are Hill Road, Tucker Road, and Main Street. Hill Road and Tucker Road are classified as collector streets, while Main Street is classified as an arterial. These streets have adequate capacity to serve the proposed development. Regarding schools, the Houston County Board of Education has been notified of this proposed development. Staff is not aware of any issues related to the capacity of educational facilities resulting from the proposed development. Number 12, whether there are existing or changing conditions affecting the use and development of the property, which gives supporting grounds for either approval or disapproval of the zoning proposal. Houston County in general, and Perry in particular, continue to see a strong demand for additional residential development. Based on staff research from the previous 2 years, using data gathered from the Houston County Tax Assessor, homes located in the R2A zoning district and near the subject property range in sales price from $139,000 to $420,000. Staff anticipates that the selling price of the proposed homes would fall within that range. City of Perry staff recommended approval of the application as reflected in the staff report dated March 22, 2021. The Perry Planning Commission recommended denial of the application requesting R3 zoning at the informational hearing held on April 12, 2021. The recommendations set forth by staff and Perry Planning Commission were related to the applicant's original request for R3 zoning. Staff has no objection to approval for the R2A zoning classification. The R2A zoning classification results in a reduction of the number of lots within the development and has less impact than the original request for R3 zoning.
There is no difference in the minimum house size of 1,200 square feet between R1 and R2A, is that correct?
That's correct.
So the house sizes would be the same in both zoning classifications?
That's correct.
However, there is a difference in the lot size between R1 and R2A, R1 being at 15,000 square feet and R2A being at 12,000 square feet, is that correct?
That's correct.
And then, as a matter of right, in R1, as has been stated, I think, several times, the developer could, if no one's stopping him from doing that as a matter of right, is that correct?
That's correct.
And with, you said here, I believe, there's approximately 10 less lots that would be allowed in R1 versus R2A?
That's correct. That's an estimate, but approximately.
So approximately it would be 63 at R2A versus 53 at R1, is that correct?
Approximately.
Approximately. Thank you.
Ms. Morton, were you, community development was never approached with an app for an R1 development?
I would like to request Mr. Wood to weigh in on that.
We have not received any applications for the R1 development.
Is this the first proposed development that come on this piece of property in one of these many years?
Councilwoman Peterson, I've been here for about 4.5 years. We have not received any application proposal for this property since I've been here.
Other questions? Thank you, Ms. Wharton. Is there anyone here that would like to speak for this rezoning application? Please give us your name and address again, Mr. Wingate.
Yes, sir. My name is Dylan Wingate. I reside at 112 Worcester Circle, Perry, Georgia. I'd just like to say I feel as though we have adequately addressed the zoning, taking it from a higher density zoning to a less higher density zoning from the R3 to the R2. And with that transition, I feel as though it's going to create positivity with growth in the area. It is a positive growth by having less homes in the R3 and having the adjoining lots being bigger lots, sufficing to the land that it does adjoin to. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Questions?
Mr. Wingate, did you consider proposing a development at R1 on this property?
No, ma'am, we did not. We wanted to be either R2 or R3 on the subject property. We had no intentions of coming in here with me in R1.
As it's been established, if you could develop it at R1, that would be 53 versus 63 homes. So with a difference of 10, first went to, I guess, standard 6. Can you say why we have no reasonable economic use at its current zone?
Being 53 is just an approximate number. I mean, you have to go and kind of get it, I guess, restricted to see if that's even, a number that it can be. We had no intentions of doing it in R1 economically or any decision we had even looked at to reduce this subject property to R1. All our intentions were either trying to be R3, but we kind of stepped back and said, okay, let's take it to a little less denser zoning, kind of see if that kind of fulfills what the area can see in positive growth and help the area for sure in that matter being R2 versus R1.
Other questions for Mr. Wingate? Thank you, Mr. Wingate. Is there anyone else that would like to speak in favor of this rezoning request? Hearing none, is there anyone here that would like to speak against this rezoning request?
Zone, our ag in the county, and it is is currently contiguous on that side to only 5-acre lots, which this zoning would not be a similar size or use. This is the issue here, not developed. I'm in favor of growth for the county and the city. You're being requested to rezone for profit. As you heard the developer say, he's not interested in developing this as R1. There's no cost analysis. There was not a cost analysis when it was presented to PNC. I specifically asked for that, and you can check the minutes for that. There has been no cost analysis of the profitability or the ability to develop this at all between R1, R2, or R3, as was originally proposed. Having this R2A is going to provide conflicts between the adjoining property in the city and the R-Ag zone property in the county. As I stated earlier in the minutes, agricultural uses, livestock, burning, chemicals, etc., would be unpleasant to somebody living in an R2 or R2A district or zone. The property zone ag were purchased with intent and zoning was settled that our ag was continuous or at least R1 residential in the land below the our ag. We are not against the rezoning of the our ag to R1. I am against rezoning it to R2 or R2A. All the homes around except for one lot is stated in the developer's home report. Only on the south side is property well locked without existing residents. So all the property surrounding this has either been built on or developed R1 or R-Ag. Within 2 miles of the property, there is 543.87 acres zoned R2 and only 258 acres zoned R1. So this is the argument. This is going to drive development in that area because this R2 is irrelevant. It's illogical. You've got already double the amount of acres zoned R2 in the same area that you've only got 258 acres zoned R1. So obviously, the availability of R1 is less than R2. The argument that this should be rezoned as residential 2A, since it's currently residential R1, can be argued on both sides. Residential is residential. There's no need for an increase in density other than the profit. You're rezoning for profit, not for planning, and for adjacent property owners and their uses and benefits. Property has not been developed since it has been speculative in nature. In fact, as the handouts that I gave you, I'd like that entered into minutes. I'm using the same handouts from the first presentation that I did in. Excuse me. It's 92.07 acres of R2 and 40 lots undeveloped in it, which is more than twice the size, almost 2.6 times, or more than 2.6 size. Times the size of the property that's under question, and it hasn't been developed, so there's obviously not a huge demand out there for R2 in this area. Another reason not to rezone it. There's no step up in the plat, which is in violation of city ordinance from R2A to the larger lot size in the plat presented for the county properties adjacent to it, which are all 5 acres. The adjacent property in 2005 was R2. It hadn't been developed either, so it's obviously not that somebody not wanting to move out there. It hadn't been developed for speculative reasons. The property zoned R1 is right now not costing the city anything to provide services to it. I said earlier, the last point is there's no law that says we have to rezone. Any request is to be approved. for R2A. It's already zoned R1. Residential is residential. Works both ways for that argument. I'd like for the minutes to show, Mr. Mayor, that my points from my earlier argument against annexation and rezoning 2A of that tract getting entered this class.
Thank you, Justin. Thank you, Mr. Beckman. We'll do that. Is there anyone else who would like to speak again? Yes, sir.
Mayor, members of council, again, I'm John Christie, 200 China Berry Lane in Perry. I would like to point one thing out to the council and to you, Mr. Mayor, that there may have been some confusion with some of the presenters who are objecting to the rezoning as to item 7A and 7B on the agenda.
Yep.
And so I was wondering if it would be possible for the council to incorporate those objections from 7A also into 7B for those presenters that have already left.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is
and I reside at 216 Shire. I'd like to point out first that I heard no objection to the development of property remaining in R1. Next point I'd like to make is regarding the 2000 flood ordinance on the property where the mention of a buffer and no retention bonds. I think it needs to be kept in mind that the current owner bought this property with those restrictions in place. So he's not, it's not like anything being done to injure him in any way as relates to those restrictions. My next observation would be that the city attorney, I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not going to get into the definition of his as it relates to vagueness, but it was a little disturbing to me that without any regard to possibly negotiating or discussion of those two conditions, they were just essentially tossed out, almost giving the developer a pass on both of them. I'll point out, too, that while we're talking about R2A now, in the very first plat of the property of the application being R3, there was a buffer in it. It's not there. So the developer seems to think he's got a pass on that, just making an observation. And as for the retention pond, the developer's own engineer in the February P&Z meeting said that they could do underground retention. At that point, may need to be kept in mind. But the bigger issue to me with respect to what I call just the tossing of those two requirements is that if the city can just scrap these conditions in its own ordinances without any what I call discussion about it, how's anybody going to have any confidence in what the city does in the future? The next observation I would make is that there's clearly nobody who has spoken in support of this rezoning application who does not have a profit motive associated with it. There's a petition signed with over 100 signatures opposing the rezoning of this property. I assume you all have that because I noticed it wasn't on the city's website until recently. So we have dozens and dozens of taxpayers and voters, and we have one developer who, I got no problem with profit, I know his family, don't know him, but his family, good folks. But again, this is not an anti-development question, this is just a zoning question. So, but going back again to the pre-council meeting minutes on, I think it was May the 4th, the minutes were, the gist of the comment in the minutes was, don't be concerned with crowds and objections, but I have to ask, who are you listening to, a developer or dozens and dozens of taxpayers and voters? I mean, just ask. If you refer to Triple Point's letter, May 3rd, I believe it is, it says the property has been zoned as R1 since, had been sold five times since 83, has sat dormant without fulfilling its intended use. So, nobody's tried to develop it. There was one brief attempt back before the recession, and it turned into such a mess that they just walked away from it. But so since the recession, there's been no attempt to develop this property in any way, shape, or form. When we talk about the diminished value as R1 in an unused state serves no purpose and it provides no opportunity for housing, that simply can't be true. It provides, as much opportunity for housing as R1 as it does R2A, maybe 10 people. But it says no purpose. I don't buy that. Yeah, property in number 8 says it's been undeveloped since 83. It's been undeveloped since the earth cooled. I mean, so. In conclusion, I would just say that in the current housing environment, we all know houses are selling right now for more than asking price, so there's plenty of demand. So there's no argument that R1 won't work. I think it may be the same developer doing R1, building R1, building in an R1 development at Stonebridge. And the last time I drove through there, there was nothing available. So any argument that R1 won't work just does not hold water. And on that, I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Ellis. We appreciate your comments. Is there anyone else here this evening that would like to speak?
Just doesn't make sense to, if you want to protect property owners and the surrounding area to maintain a uniform development and to keep it as R1, and at some point in time, if the need is there for more houses, more tax base for the city, more goods and services, then it will happen. But we don't need to force it. We don't, by rezoning, and these people didn't go and buy this property with their eyes closed. It was R1. So let's leave it R1. And I appreciate the time, Mayor, Council. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. Is there anyone here that would like to speak against that could offer additional information for the council? Hearing none, at this time, this public hearing is closed. I'd like to thank each and every one of you for your participation in this process. Council members, item 8 on our agenda are a review of minutes. You have been provided with the minutes of the May 3rd, 2021 work session, the May 4th, 2021 council meeting, and the May 4th, 2021 council meeting. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to approve these minutes as written. Motion and second. Is there any additions, deletions, or changes? Hearing none, all in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Please look for record to show that the minutes were approved unanimously. Item 9 is old business. 9A is special exception application 0071-2021. Ms. Wharton. Comments or questions?
11B. These are ordinances for the first reading and introduction. 11B was the first reading of an ordinance for the annexation of property to the city of Perry. The property is located at 111 Hill Road. Tax map number is 00058003400. There is no action required on the part of council. This will come before you at our next regular meeting on June the 1st for a vote. Do you have any questions, additional questions for Ms. Wharton? Thank you, council. Item 11B2 is the first reading of an ordinance for the rezoning of property from R-AG County Residential Agricultural District to R-2AC Single Family Residential District. The property is located at 111 Hill Road. The tax map number is 00058003400. There's no action required on the part of the council, and this will come before you at our next regularly scheduled meeting on June the 1st for a vote. Any additional questions at this time from this board? Thank you. 11B3 is the first reading of an ordinance for the rezoning of property from R-1 Single Family Residential District to R-2A City Single Family Residential District. The property is located at 125 Hill Road. The tax map number is 0P0480035000. No action is required by council this evening. Again, this will come before you at our next regularly scheduled meeting on June the 1st. Any questions for Ms. Wharton relative to this rezoning request? Thank you, council. Item 11C are resolutions for consideration and adoption. 11C1 is a resolution authorizing an intergovernmental agreement between the City of Perry and the Perry Public Facilities Authority for the issuance of bonds to fund additional and improvements to the sewer and wastewater system of the City of Perry, approving a bond purchase agreement and approving the bond resolution adopted by the Perry Public Facilities Authority. Mrs. Newton.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor and Council, tonight for your consideration is a resolution to authorize an intergovernmental agreement with the Perry Public Facilities Authority and to approve the bond purchase agreement. The Perry Public Facilities Authority met tonight at 5:30 and they have already approved these agreements to move forward with the issuance of the bonds. Tonight we have with us Stephen Swenson, our bond counsel, and Mr. Bill Camp with Raymond James.
Stretch of the way per Georgia law.
We're going to close that bond issue on June 22nd and transfer into your account $4.3 million for sewer expansion, stormwater retention facility, wastewater treatment plant design and permit. I'm happy to answer any questions. I gave you just a very brief summary, but I'm happy to answer any questions you all might have.
Council members, questions relative to this bond? I know we've had a lot of conversations relative to this as we've been planning to put this Bear Branch extension in. So, additional questions?
And thank you on behalf of my firm, Mr. Swenson's firm. We appreciate being able to work for the city of Perry. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate all the hard work on this.
Thank you.
Council members, at this time I'll entertain a motion to approve the resolution that has been outlined by Ms. Newton.
So moved.
Second. Motion and second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Please let the record show that the bond issuance was approved unanimously. Thank you, Council. Item 11C2 is a resolution to amend fee schedules relative to the James E. Worrell Community Center rental rates. Ms. Newby, I know we have a request to table this at this time.
Yes, sir. It's my understanding that there's some additional information that needs to be discussed with the Department of Leisure Services relative to the proposed rates, and so we would ask that you table this item to your next meeting, please.
Council members, you've heard the recommendation at this time. I'm entertaining a motion to table this resolution until our June the 1st meeting. So
moved.
There's a motion and a second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Please let the record show that this resolution has been tabled until action on our June the 1st meeting. Item 11D is the Office of City Manager. 11D1 is recommend establishment of a senior court administrator job classification. Mr. Gilmore.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor and Council, you have in your packet a job description for the senior court administrator. This is part of the formal management succession plan for municipal court, and the recommendation from administration is that you approve this job classification. This will not be an additional position. There is no one who will be moving into this position. It's just part of the career track process.
Council members, what questions do you have? Hearing none, at this time I'll entertain a motion to approve the establishment of this position as outlined by Mr. Gilmore. Motion and second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Please let the record show that the recommendation of the establishment of this position was approved unanimously. Thank you, Council. 11E is Flint EMC right-of-way easement for 3.14-acre parcel. It's 0P0480500000. Ms. Newby.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor and Council, for your approval tonight is a Flint EMC right-of-way easement for underground power. This is for the 3.14-acre parcel that the city has received by donation at the end of 2020. Since the easement does convey ownership interest, albeit through an easement, this is why it's coming to need for approval.
Council members, questions relevant to this? Hearing none at this time, I'll entertain a motion to approve the right-of-way easement as outlined by Ms. Smith.
So moved.
Second. Motion and second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Please let the record show that the right-of-way easement request was approved unanimously. Thank you, Ms. Newby. It's the roadway. It's a roadway going through it. There's a pumping station in that type. They have, as I understand it, underground utilities running through it.
Yes, sir. That's what they already have an easement that actually crosses the property.
Thank you.
Mayor Proton. Mr. Peters.
Yes.
Mr. King.
No question.
Thank you. Mr. Gilmore, anything else for us this evening?
Yes, Council, I have two items. The first one, you may remember yesterday in the budget presentation that Mr. Wood was talking about in the recommended budget is some upgrade work for the software system. And you may remember that he mentioned the short time frame that we have with that before the price doubles. Everybody remember that? I'd like to request Council approve that we go ahead and place the order for that software since it is in the recommended budget because we need to have it done. It was outlined by Mr. Wood, and I would hate to have to pay twice as much because of some regular process delay.
Questions, Council members? Hearing none, I don't want to entertain a motion to approve the purchase of the software as outlined by Mr. Gilmore. Motion and a second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Please let the record show that unanimous approval of the software purchase for community development.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. The last item I have is I believe that we advise you all that the city has been awarded to participate in the Vacant Property Leadership Institute as put on by the National League of Cities. Mind you, we're one of three cities in Georgia that were selected. We're the only non-metro city to be selected, so I think that's quite a compliment or a statement. But primarily a compliment to us about the package that's put together. We have talked a number of times about the issues relative to vacant property, blight, those type of things, and I think it'd be very beneficial. What I am requesting from Council would be their approval to accept this grant with the understanding that it will involve the city having to pay some transportation costs for participants to go to Austin, Texas for this event. The grant or program itself pays for the housing, pays for most of the eating, pays the tuition, you know, all these type of things, but the awarded city is obligated for providing transportation for those participants to go. I'd like to recommend to Council that you approve this grant with those conditions so we can move ahead and advise the National League of Cities. The reason I'm bringing this up now is there's a short time frame in which we have to respond back to.
Council member questions? I'd like to not only Mr. Gilmore's, I understand that Ms. Wharton and the work that we had done on it. There's only 27 cities nationwide, as I understand, that was awarded this. So you're in a very elite group. And there was a great deal of work done on the part of community development, securing letters from people all over the state and all over the Southeast to support this. So my compliments to you for the hard work and the quality of package that was put together. Thank you very much. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to approve the cost to support the housing initiative transportation costs as outlined by Mr. Gilmore.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Please let the record show that it was approved unanimously. Thank you. Mr. Gilmore, anything else?
No, sir. Thank you.
Ms. Newby, anything for us? Item 13 is department head items. Ms. King, anything for us this evening?
No, sir.
Mr. Worthy?
Nothing,
sir. Mr. Wood, anything additional?
Yes, Mayor. I would like to ask for a clarification on a vote that you took earlier tonight. And I don't know if it's appropriate after the vote was taken, but if Mr. Jones could clarify whether his motion included the conditions on that special exception that were recommended by the Planning Commission, as well as the one that you added tonight?
Yes, it did.
Thank you.
Anything else? Ms. Wharton, anything this evening? Chief Lynn?
Yes, sir. Mayor and Council, two things. I'll be brief. First, thank you for allowing us the opportunity to recognize our up-and-coming leadership in the police department. Those faces you saw tonight are the future of the department, and they're doing great work. Secondly, I want to remind you that tomorrow we're having a retirement luncheon in this space for Lieutenant Ken Ezel, who is ending his career with the city after almost 25 years and relocating to Ohio. And Ken is here tonight. If you want to recognize him anyway, if you can't make the luncheon tomorrow, but I just wanted to. I'm ahead of myself. Lunch is Thursday, not Wednesday. It's been a long week, you know, so Thursday at noon in this space, and that'll also be his last day of work for us. He's been a very dedicated part of our department and a very essential part. Thank you.
Comments, council members? Just like to thank Mr. Ezel. I think I'm going to have an opportunity on Thursday to do that officially, but here this evening in front of press and everything, I'd like to officially say thank you for your outstanding performance, and we wish you very well as you move on to Ohio and start your new life up there. So thank you very much for what you've done. Chief Parker. Open to the public, and we'll be advertising that. So if you haven't had your vaccination,
the House and Healthcare Organization to get it done here in this facility. We will also offer that opportunity the next weekend at Juneteenth with Ms. Brian Grace's program that day, with vaccinations being offered during that day as well. So it will be available